The U.S. military announces the end of its mission to install and operate a temporary floating pier off Gaza. Announced by President Joe Biden in March, the pier was a massive endeavor that took about 1,000 U.S. forces to execute. Aid began flowing through the pier in May, but bad weather and distribution challenges inside Gaza limited its effectiveness. The UN World Food Program paused operations at the pier in June due to security concerns. Still, the U.S. military says it achieved its intended effect of surging a high volume of aid into Gaza. The UN has long said maritime deliveries were no substitute for land access to avert a famine in the enclave after months of war between Israel and Hamas. A meeting of the UN Security Council on the war in Gaza briefly interrupted by two protesters calling for the release of Israeli hostages held by Hamas. Protests inside the UN headquarters in New York are rare, and the woman left the chamber after being asked to do so by security. The demonstration came as Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov began to address the council after a statement by Israel's ambassador. Russia is the president of the 15-member body for July.
Unequivocally condemned the terrorist attack against Israel of October 7, 2023. However, what is now happening in Gaza is unacceptable collective punishment of the civilian population. The military clearance of the Gaza Strip, the most densely populated place on the planet, which for years has been called an open-air prison, has been underway for nearly 300 days. The large-scale military operation, which Israel has conducted together with its American ally, has resulted in horrifying statistics in terms of casualties and destruction.
We need an immediate humanitarian ceasefire and the immediate and unconditional release of all hostages. With the tireless efforts of Egypt, Qatar, and the United States, negotiations to formulate a deal for the release of the hostages and a ceasefire continue with some reported progress. The parties must reach such a deal now. The humanitarian situation in Gaza is a moral stain on us all. International humanitarian law must be respected at all times and by all parties.
Britain's King Charles set out Prime Minister Keir Starmer's legislative agenda. In a ceremony full of pageantry at the Upper House of Parliament, Charles read out the laws of the government that the government is prioritizing after the centre-left Labour Party won a large majority at this month's election. The package of more than 35 bills will focus on reviving the economy and tackling issues from an acute housing shortage to a cost-of-living crisis.
My Lords and members of the House of Commons, my government will govern in service to the country. My government's legislative program will be mission-led and based upon the principles of security, fairness, and opportunity for all. Stability will be the cornerstone of my government's economic policy, and every decision will be consistent with its fiscal rules. It will legislate to ensure that all significant tax and spending changes are subject to an independent assessment by the Office for Budget Responsibility.
The King's speech was followed by a debate between Starmer and former Prime Minister Rishi Sunak. Starmer faces a number of daunting challenges, including improving struggling public services with little room for more spending.
What people really want is change, and change is what this government of service will deliver. A King's speech that takes the brakes off our economy and shows to the British people that politics can be a force for good, the vehicle for improving lives of millions, no matter who you voted for.
14 high school students in Tokyo hospitalized after eating spicy chips. The snack, called R18 curry chips, comes with a warning for those under the age of 18 and those with high blood pressure and a weak stomach to not consume it. The students who were rushed to the hospital complained of pain in their stomach and mouth. all remained conscious and were treated for minor symptoms. The maker of the snack has issued an apology and wished the students a speedy recovery. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our correspondent, Henny Espinosa.
Hey guys, here are news making headlines for Filipinos in North America.
End the occupation! China out now! End the occupation! China out now!
Filipino-American activists from coast to coast held simultaneous protests in front of Chinese consulates to protect Philippine sovereignty and reject China's aggression in the South China Sea as they mark the 8th anniversary of the arbitral award that nullified China's claims in the disputed territories. These protesters say China's creeping invasion and occupation of Philippine territories as part of its expansionist policy in Asia must be stopped.
If we don't say anything, if we don't protest, essentially that means we're giving in to the illegal occupation of China. Remember though, friends, this is not an all-out one-day occupation. This has been happening for years and years.
Last June 17, armed Chinese Coast Guard personnel repeatedly rammed into two Philippine Navy supply vessels at the Ayuhin Shoal, which led to Filipino sailors getting injured and several Philippine Navy rifles seized. As the United States once again urged China to stop aggression in the South China Sea, Beijing chose to defend its actions, saying its Coast Guard was lawful and beyond reproach. And finally, Fiesta Mosa USA in Florida 2024, the largest indoor Filipino fiesta in the southern USA, is happening on Saturday, July 27th. Now in its 15th year, hundreds of attendees are expected to come together at the Osceola Heritage Park in Kissimmee, Florida, to celebrate everything Filipino, from sumptuous cuisine to products and services to cultural performances. This year, ABS-CBN stars like Kabugera Maymay Entrata and Teleserye royalty Paolo Avellino will bring joy to fans from the Happy Hour event by the Filipino Channel.
And those are the news making headlines today. You can catch more TFC news on the ABS-CBN News website, YouTube channel, and app. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the Rundown.
Donald Trump's running mate set to introduce himself to the national arena, taking the stage at the Republican National Convention in Milwaukee. Ohio Senator J.D. Vance will be speaking a few moments from now to make a case for the Republican ticket. Vance is expected to share the story of his upbringing in an effort to paint Republicans as the party that best understands the challenges faced by many Americans. He will also make his position public on issues like inflation, immigration, and drugs. Speaking at a fundraiser ahead of his crucial speech in Milwaukee, Vance said he will use his upcoming address to drive home the call for Trump to be reelected.
After he literally got shot, came within millimeters of losing his life in the service of this country, what did he do? I remember what I did. I was pissed. As soon as I knew he was okay, I felt relief, and then I was like, I cannot believe an assassin tried to take down the President of the United States. I was mad about it. Was he mad and angry? He called for national unity. He called for calm. He showed leadership, my friends, that the media keeps on saying they want somebody to tone down the temperature. Well, Donald Trump got shot and he toned down the temperature. That's what a real leader does.
The Ohio senator was once a fierce critic of Trump, who even referred to the former U.S. president as America's Hitler. But he has since become one of Trump's most aggressive defenders. Republican presidential nominee Donald Trump appeared on stage in Milwaukee for a rehearsal walkthrough ahead of his primetime address. Trump will formally accept the party's nomination Thursday. His address will be the culmination of the four-day Republican National Convention, which began days after his assassination attempt in Pennsylvania. U.S. President Joe Biden tests positive for COVID-19. Biden was set to speak at an event in Las Vegas as part of an effort to rally Hispanic voters ahead of the November elections.
Regrettably, I was just on the phone with President Biden, and he shared his deep disappointment at not being able to join us this afternoon. The president has been at many events, as we all know, and he just tested positive for COVID. He said to tell my folks that we're not going to get rid of him that quickly. We're going to have a chance to hear from him in the future directly. He's just really sorry.
Before testing positive for COVID, Biden made a pit stop at a Mexican restaurant in Nevada, greeting several diners and posing for pictures with them. Aside from the COVID news, here's another hit for Biden's campaign. California Representative Adam Schiff becomes the most prominent Democrat yet to publicly call on Biden to drop out of the race. In a statement, Schiff said it's time for Biden to pass the torch and in doing so, secure his legacy as U.S. president. Schiff also said he has serious concerns over Biden's ability to defeat Donald Trump, warning a second Trump presidency will undermine the foundation of American democracy. Democratic concerns about the 81-year-old incumbent's ability to beat Trump or to serve another 4 years in office surged after Biden's shaky debate performance last month. U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris speaks up publicly for the first time on the assassination attempt on Donald Trump. Harris condemned Saturday's shooting, calling it a heinous and cowardly act. She also echoed U.S. President Joe Biden's position, violence has no place in the U.S.
I do want to discuss briefly what happened on Saturday. I've not had a chance yet to publicly talk about it, but I will say a few words about the attempt on the life of former President Trump over the weekend. As we all know, it was a heinous, horrible, and cowardly act. My husband Doug and I are thankful he was not seriously injured. The one of the questions we now confront is about the way we should engage with one another in this campaign. On Sunday evening, our President Joe Biden issued a call for unity. And there must be unity around the idea that while our nation's history has been scarred by political violence, violence is never acceptable.